In the transportation field, more and more businesses are realizing the benefits of using natural gas as an abundant, safe, and clean-burning alternative to gasoline and diesel fuel. And one of the companies leading the way in alternative fuel storage and delivery is Agility Fuel Systems. Hello, I'm Tony Noakes. At Agility, our goal is to provide timely, world-class engineering, installation support, advice, and aftermarket service that makes it easy for our customers to modernize their fleets of heavy-duty trucks, buses, and specialty vehicles. In business since 1996, Agility Fuel Systems has deployed over 25,000 systems in fleets across North America and around the world. Agility manufactures and installs natural gas fuel systems at our facilities in California, Alabama, and British Columbia, while service is available through our network of factory-certified dealers or right at your site, ensuring the highest level of customer satisfaction. In this video, we'll take a closer look at liquefied natural gas, LNG, and how it's used to safely power vehicles. And we'll show you how to operate an Agility LNG system and how to perform routine maintenance and basic troubleshooting. Our objective is to raise your awareness and knowledge of these systems to ensure their safe and efficient operation. This program is divided into 14 segments, starting with this introduction. Then we go into system overview, system components, safety, fueling, the daily system inspection, pressure relief valves, depressurizing and defueling, ice and low temperature, hot work, methane detection, tank conditioning, leak detection and repair, and we close out the video with important information on how to contact Agility Fuel Systems for product support. Helping me today will be Chris Chokas. Welcome, Chris.
Thanks, Tony.
Chris is an Agility Service Advisor, and he'll be demonstrating the proper procedures as well as showing you some of the features and functions throughout this presentation. You ready?
Ready.
Let's get started. In this segment, we're going to review what makes natural gas unique and some basics about how temperature and pressure correlate before moving on to an overview of a typical Agility LNG system. As you know, natural gas is flammable. However, it only burns within a narrow range when mixed with air in a ratio of between 5% and 15%. Natural gas will not burn in the highly concentrated form found inside the tanks. Natural gas is also odorless, tasteless, and non-toxic. That is why mercaptan is often injected into the gas to give it that rotten egg odor, which allows for easier leak detection. However, LNG is too cold for mercaptan, so LNG has no odor. Another fact, natural gas in gaseous form is lighter than air and rises quickly and diffuses into the atmosphere when released. However, in its liquid form, LNG is heavier than air and may pool momentarily on the ground if spilled, but it quickly boils off to its gaseous form, rises and diffuses into the atmosphere. Liquefied natural gas, or LNG, is natural gas, primarily methane CH4, that has been converted temporarily to liquid form by cooling it to minus 260 degrees Fahrenheit. A substance this cold is called cryogenic. This cooling process reduces its volume by a factor of more than 600 over natural gas at atmospheric pressure. This permits efficient storage and transport of the fuel. LNG is usually sold by the diesel gallon equivalent, or DGE. Approximately 2 gallons of LNG equals 1 DGE. Explaining how Agility's LNG systems operate requires that we first discuss how fuel pressure and temperature are related to each other within the system. This simplified vapor saturation curve shows the relationship between pressure and temperature for LNG. LNG is always somewhere on this curve. When the temperature in the tank increases, so does the pressure. When the temperature decreases, the pressure goes down. It's important to understand that the pressure in the tank is directly related to the temperature of the fuel, not the amount of fuel in the tank. Agility's standard requires a minimum tank pressure of 100 PSI, which corresponds to a minimum temperature of minus 200 degrees Fahrenheit. This LNG is called saturated, or green LNG, differentiating it from colder, or blue LNG. The only difference between green and blue LNG is the temperature at which the fuel is dispensed into the vehicle. It's important to note, putting cold blue fuel into a standard agility fuel system will cause pressure in the system to be too low and the engine won't run. If operation with unsaturated cold or blue LNG is intended, then agility's optional pressure builder is required. Coming up next, we'll look at system components. Now let's take a look at the typical LNG fuel system following the flow of natural gas from the tank through the system components to the engine. The system includes the LNG tank, and on most heavy vehicles, there may be multiple tanks. Typically, LNG tanks are mounted on a truck's side rail, similarly to the way diesel tanks are mounted. In transit bus applications, they are usually found on the vehicle's roof. These highly insulated stainless steel tanks store LNG fuel. Multiple tanks are configured to operate in parallel. The operator doesn't have to fill them separately or select which tank is being used to fill the engine. Instead, the system has a single fuel fill connection and a single vent to station connection. Other components of the system include interconnecting tubing and hoses, a heat exchanger, sometimes called a vaporizer, and several fuel control devices such as the automatic fuel shutoff valve, overpressure regulator, and pressure control regulator. There's also a fuel gauge that displays the fuel level to the driver, and a low temperature light that warns the driver of abnormal system operation. Agility's standard LNG systems do not include a fuel pump. Instead, the tank pressure is used to feed fuel to the engine. No additional pressure boost is needed. When using blue fuel, however, Agility's optional cold fuel pressure builder is used to boost system pressure to provide the engine with adequate fuel. Even though the tank is very well insulated, a small amount of heat is always flowing into the tank from the outside, so pressure will gradually rise at a rate of approximately 10 to 15 psi per day, which is equivalent to about 3 to 5 degrees Fahrenheit per day. A series of regulators and valves manage the pressure in the tank so that it never exceeds 230 psi, and the pressure delivered to the engine never exceeds 150 psi. Now we'll show you how these regulators, valves, and associated parts work together to manage tank pressure and feed a constant flow of gas to the engine. Let's begin with the tank itself. There are actually two tanks, one inside the other. The inner tank is wrapped with multiple layers of insulation, and the space between the tanks is vacuum sealed, much like a thermos. This cap on the outside of the tank is called the evacuation port cap, and must be kept in place to prevent damage to the vacuum seal. If the cap is missing or damaged, contact Agility Fuel Systems product support or an authorized dealer for instructions. Tanks are filled with LNG at the station through the fill receptacle. The LNG fuel fill receptacle is a pressurized connection and requires a positive lock with the station nozzle for fuel to flow. Agility LNG systems are designed to fill as quickly as possible, achieving a fill rate as fast or faster than conventional diesel fuel systems. The fill check valve prevents the tank contents from escaping in case of an accident or fill coupler failure. Note that if your vehicle has two or more LNG tanks, there will only be one fill receptacle and one vent connection back to the station. The tanks are connected and normally operate in parallel. Inside the main tank, a ullage tank is integrated to guard against overfilling and allow for fuel expansion and standby time. The pressure control regulator manages the flow of fuel from the tank when the vehicle is in operation. It supplies vapor when the tank pressure is above 120 psi, or liquid when the pressure is below 120 psi. As vapor is withdrawn from the tank, tank pressure is reduced. When liquid is withdrawn, pressure is maintained. Remember, as the tank warms over time, the tank pressure will slowly increase. By allowing vapor to be withdrawn from the tank, the pressure control regulator keeps tank pressure from getting too high. The inline check valve creates a small 2 psi back pressure when liquid fuel is being withdrawn. Restricting liquid flow this way helps the pressure control regulator work more effectively to rapidly reduce tank pressure. At the outlet of the tank, the excess flow valve protects against catastrophic failure downstream. The red-handled fuel shutoff valve on each tank allows the tank to be isolated for service, but is left open during operation. There's also a gray-handled vent valve. This allows excess vapor to be returned to the station during fueling, and is otherwise normally closed. When liquid fuel is being drawn from the tank, a heat exchanger is used to vaporize it into the gaseous form required by the engine. The heat exchanger circulates hot coolant from the engine to warm the LNG. LNG systems have an automatic shutoff valve. Only when the key switch is turned on will fuel flow to the engine for operation. The pressure of the gas exiting the heat exchanger going to the engine is limited by the overpressure regulator not to exceed 150 psi. A capacitance liquid level sensor is located inside the tank, as you see here. It sends a signal to an electronic control unit, which in turn drives the vehicle's OEM fuel level gauge. Each tank has its own mechanical gauge to indicate the pressure inside. Often there are two pressure gauges located at the rear of the tank. Note that these gauges only show the pressure, not the amount of LNG in the tank. The primary and secondary relief valves protect the tank from excess pressure. The primary valve activates at 230 psi, and the escaping vapor is vented safely. The secondary valve is capped and activates at 350 psi. If you ever see the red secondary relief valve cap missing, you must consider the fuel system unsafe and take appropriate action as described in Segment 7, Pressure Relief Valves. Gas at between 100 and 150 psi at coolant temperature leaves the overpressure regulator and goes to the engine low pressure filter, which is not part of the agility system. Back on an actual rig, a hose from the low pressure filter routes gas to the engine. At the engine, an internal regulator further reduces the gas pressure. To illustrate what we've just covered, here's a little real-world scenario. When a driver parks his LNG tractor on Friday night and doesn't start it again until Monday morning, this is what happens. Tank pressure when the truck was parked equaled 120 psi, the pressure control regulator set point. The truck was parked for 2 days with a 15 psi pressure rise per day. By Monday morning, the tank showed 150 psi. Note, the tank did not reach 230 psi, so it did not vent. When the driver starts the engine Monday morning, since the tank pressure is above 120 psi, the pressure control regulator will be open, allowing vapor flow to the engine. As the engine runs, tank pressure will decrease until it reaches 120 psi. The pressure control regulator then closes, preventing vapor from entering the heat exchanger. The pressure control regulator will then keep the tank pressure at 120 psi until the engine is shut off again. Now that you have a feel for the LNG system and its components, let's take a closer look at the various procedures you may perform when working with an LNG system. In this segment, we'll cover some important safety procedures you'll need to know. When working with cryogenic LNG, personal protective equipment, PPE, is required to help avoid injury. Skin contact with LNG, cold gas, or tubing carrying it will cause burns. In fact, blindness can result if LNG gets in your eyes. When fueling, always wear safety glasses, a face shield, insulated gloves, long pants, long sleeve shirt, and proper footwear. When servicing LNG systems, always wear the appropriate PPE required for the task. Never tighten or loosen a fitting under pressure. Depressurize or defuel the system as necessary for the work needed. Never use an open flame to search for a leak. And of course, do not smoke. Keep all possible ignition sources, such as welding or grinding, away from the LNG system and fueling areas. LNG vehicles should be parked and serviced outdoors where vented gas cannot accumulate, or proper provisions made for indoor storage and service. Failure to follow all these safety procedures may result in damage or personal injury, and no one wants that to happen. So be sure to always inform the others in the shop when you are servicing LNG systems. To identify LNG vehicles to emergency responders, they must display this blue diamond symbol. In an LNG emergency, such as a vehicle fire, major collision, or uncontrolled fuel leak, call 911. Then when and if it is safe to do so, shut off the ignition switch and isolate the fuel by closing both the red and gray handled valves located at the end of all LNG tanks. Evacuate the immediate area, but do not set out road flares. If LNG spills on the pavement, do not spray water on it. Water can cause LNG to splatter violently, increasing fire danger. Allow the LNG to vaporize and dissipate into the atmosphere. These are suggested guidelines. Always follow your company or station policies and procedures for all safety practices. Okay, now let's cover fueling. As we mentioned in segment two, standard agility LNG fuel systems are designed to operate on saturated LNG with a minimum temperature of minus 200 degrees Fahrenheit and a corresponding minimum pressure of 100 psi. If equipped with an optional cold fuel pressure builder system, agility LNG fuel systems can operate on cold or unsaturated fuel. Always be sure to fill your LNG system with the proper fuel. The fueling procedure shown in the following demonstration is the same for either fuel. So, let's get started as we demonstrate how to properly refuel your LNG vehicle. LNG stations are similar to diesel stations. Fuel is stored in large tanks, and a dispenser pump is used. As we mentioned earlier, always put on the proper PPE before fueling. To begin fueling, unless you have the optional pressure builder, make sure you select saturated or green LNG at the pump. Connect the ground cable from the pump to the vehicle tank. If pressure inside the tank exceeds 150 psi, clean the vent connector with compressed air and connect the vent hose from the filling station to the tank vent connector. Open the gray-handled vent valve on each tank and allow the system to vent down to about 140 psi. This allows the fuel dispenser to overcome the pressure in the tank and flow fuel into the tank. Once this is achieved, close the vent valves and return the vent hose to the filling station. Never leave the vent hose connected with the vent valve open during the fueling process, or fuel may simply circulate into and then out of the tank and back into the station. Use compressed air to clean the fill receptacle and nozzle. Now you can insert the nozzle into the receptacle, lock it in place, and begin fueling. The pump will shut off automatically when the fill is complete. Disconnect and return the nozzle to the fuel pump. It's important to point out that the single receptacle will fill all tanks. Now, before we close out fueling procedures, let's cover transporting and towing LNG vehicles. When transporting LNG vehicles by decking or piggybacking or towing, it's best if their LNG tanks are empty. If an LNG vehicle with fuel aboard must be transported or towed, precautions must be followed to prevent liquid fuel from venting out of the vent stack if pressure reaches the relief valve setting. Before transporting, the fuel gauges must read less than 1/8 full. Drive or run the engine to reduce tank pressure to the pressure control regulator set point, 120 psi, before mounting to the tow vehicle. The driver must monitor pressure on all decked truck tanks at the beginning and end of each trip. The tanks must not exceed 200 psi at any time. Any tank at or above 200 psi must have the tank pressure reduced to below 180 psi by either running the engine or manually venting the tanks. That completes fueling procedures. Now, we're ready to cover the daily inspection process. Before operating your vehicle, we recommend that you perform this daily system inspection to ensure it's safe and ready for the road. The engine manufacturer recommends that you drain the low pressure filter daily before starting the vehicle. Follow the manufacturer's instructions to see if you're getting oil or water in your fuel. Then, before entering the cab, check the methane detection center for a green light. Now, in the cab, turn the ignition key to the on position, and check the fuel level shown by the dashboard fuel gauge. Next, check the tank pressure gauge, which should show between 100 and 230 PSI. Assure that the red cap on the pressure relief valve on each tank is in place. Make sure the red-handled fuel shutoff valve is open and the gray-handled vent valve is closed on each tank. Next, as part of your normal walk around, check the system for damage, the sound of leaks, ice, or frosting. But keep in mind that some frosting is normal around the connections at the end of the tank, sometimes referred to as the knuckle of the tank. If everything checks out okay, then you're good to go. And now you're ready to take a look at the pressure relief valves. Before we talk about pressure relief valves, which are critical components of the LNG system, you should know that all agility systems meet or exceed NFPA 52, the National Fire Protection Association standard for natural gas vehicles. As you've seen here on the back of the tank, the primary relief valve will vent gas to the atmosphere if pressure exceeds 230 PSI. If tank pressures are above 240 PSI, the primary relief valve is not functioning correctly. The vehicle must immediately be removed from service and the primary relief valve replaced. If the secondary relief valve red cap is missing, the primary relief valve may have failed, causing the secondary relief valve to open. The vehicle must immediately be removed from service, inspected, and repaired. To safely perform various maintenance operations, sometimes you must first depressurize or defuel the system. What's the difference between depressurizing and defueling? A lot. Here's how it breaks down. When you're working downstream of the red-handled fuel valve, that portion of the fuel system can be depressurized while still conserving the fuel in the tanks. This is done by isolating the pressure in all tanks from the rest of the system plumbing. But when work must be done on the fuel system upstream of the red-handled valve, all fuel inside the tank must be removed, either vented or stored elsewhere. You must defuel before servicing tanks, liquid and vapor shutoff valves, the pressure control regulator, primary secondary relief valves, or any component plumbed to the knuckle of the tank. Here's how to depressurize the system. First, park the vehicle in a well-ventilated area where natural gas can't accumulate. Then, close the red-handled fuel shutoff valve on each tank. Start the engine and run it until it stops. Remove the ignition key and verify that the engine supply gauge reads zero. Follow proper vehicle lockout procedures. The system is now depressurized with all fuel confined to the tanks and ready for safe servicing. When work is completed, repressurize the system following these steps. Open the red-handled shutoff valves, make sure the gray-handled vent valves are closed, and the system is now repressurized and ready for operation. Remove the vehicle lockout. If you have to defuel the tanks, first, depressurize the system as we just described. After removing the shroud grate, remove the 3/8 inch line from the excess flow valve to the bulkhead as shown here. Remove the excess flow valve. Install a 3/8 inch NPT elbow onto the fitting at the red-handled fuel shutoff valve outlet. Install a 1/2 inch stainless steel tubing onto the elbow to create a temporary discharge vent. The tubing should be approximately 6 feet or 2 meters tall, as shown here, to safely carry vapor away. Attach a grounding cable to the tank. Now, slowly open the red shutoff valve to allow fuel to flow from the tank to the atmosphere. Do not leave the vehicle unattended while defueling. When fuel stops flowing, but prior to working on the system, make sure you remove all remaining combustible gas by purging the system with nitrogen. First, shut the red-handled valves. Connect a pressure-regulated nitrogen purge cart to the fill receptacle on the vehicle's tank and pressurize the system to 10 PSI. Then disconnect the cart and replace the fill cap. Open the red-handled valves to let the tank pressure bleed off to zero through the defuel tube. then close the red-handled valves. Remove the defuel tube. Install a MacroTech female vent connector tool to the system's vent-to-station connection. Open all gray-handled vent valves and allow all remaining nitrogen to vent from the MacroTech connector tool. Listen for a no-flow condition to indicate empty. Close the gray-handled vent valves, disconnect the MacroTech connector, and replace the vent cap. Remove the ground cable. Once the nitrogen purge is complete, the system is safe to work on. When all work is completed, don't forget to reinstall the excess flow valve and the line from the excess flow valve to the bulkhead. Always clean the threads and reapply two or three wraps of nickel impregnated Teflon tape on the threads when reusing tapered fittings. Refuel the tank following the tank conditioning procedures described in segment 12, tank conditioning. Ice and frost are an everyday part of working with LNG, so it's important to understand the dynamics that are normal and those that may represent a concern. While fueling, it's normal for frost and ice to appear on the fuel nozzle, tanks, various tubing, and fuel lines. More frost and ice will form in humid or damp weather. However, when ice and frost buildup becomes excessive, it should be removed to eliminate interference with the operation of the hand valves. So remove ice buildup by gently flowing water from a hose. Never use tools to chip away ice. A low temperature light is mounted on the vehicle dashboard. It will illuminate if the fuel supplied to the engine is abnormally cold. If this light is illuminated, the vehicle should not be operated and must be repaired. That covers key elements regarding ice and low temperature in the system. Next up, we move from cold to hot work. In some cases, the service area where you're working on an LNG system will include hot work, such as welding or grinding. This can create additional safety issues, so be sure to follow these precautions and recommended procedures. When welding or grinding more than 6 feet or 2 meters from the LNG system, it is not necessary to defuel the LNG tanks, but the fuel should be contained in the tanks by fully depressurizing the system as described in segment 8. Ensure that the vehicle is in a well-ventilated area. Do not park the vehicle in an area where natural gas may accumulate. However, if you have to perform hot work closer than 6 feet or 2 meters from the LNG tanks, they must be completely defueled. Again, see segment 8, depressurizing and defueling, for the proper steps to follow. After you have properly defueled the tanks, all LNG components, including the tanks and fuel lines, must be covered with fireproof blankets. A single spark or weld slag could compromise LNG components, resulting in a hazardous situation. If you have questions on your particular system configuration, please contact your local Agility service provider or Agility product support. Helping to maintain safe working conditions includes ensuring a methane-free environment. Because LNG is odorless and because you can't see it if it were to leak from the fuel system, all LNG vehicles are equipped with a methane detection system that will sound an alarm and illuminate a warning light if methane gas is detected. There are usually two or more zones on the vehicle where sensors are placed. Zone 1 is generally inside the cab, and zone 2 is inside the engine compartment. If dangerous levels of methane are detected in the cab or the engine compartment, progressive warnings will be displayed on the driver's dashboard. Lights indicate trace levels of methane. Significant levels trigger lights and a buzzer. The in-cab methane detector components include the control panel, audible alarm, green lights, red lights, and the in-cab sensor. Please note that in some cases, Agility supplies this methane detection system as an integrated part of the fuel system, while other times it is supplied by the chassis original equipment manufacturer. In cases where the system is supplied by the chassis OEM, the system may be configured differently than what is shown in this video. Next up, we'll cover tank conditioning. Tank conditioning is an important and necessary process when dealing with empty or defueled tanks. Empty tanks at ambient temperature are hot compared to LNG. On initial filling of a hot tank, the pressure inside the tank will rise rapidly as the cold LNG entering the hot tank is quickly vaporized, and the filling process will stop automatically before the tank is filled. In this case, a special conditioning procedure must be followed to fill the tanks. And if an LNG tank is ever defueled or removed from service, it must again be conditioned upon first fill. First, only if filling a brand new tank, vent the tank to the atmosphere to 0 psi. This removes nitrogen from the new tank. Do not vent this gas back to the station. Connect the fill station hose to the vehicle, as described in Segment 5, Fueling. Fill the tank until the station pump stops. The pressure in the tank will typically be anywhere from 200 to 230 psi at this point. With the tank pressure at 200 psi or above, check the setting of the overpressure regulator and, if necessary, adjust it as follows. The tank must be at 200 psi or greater to do this. First, disconnect from the fuel station, then start and run the engine at idle. Loosen the jam nut on the overpressure regulator to free the adjustment T-handle. Adjust the pressure to 148 psi as measured at the overpressure regulator gauge. Then tighten the jam nut to lock the handle and setting. Once the regulator is set, stop the engine and connect the station vent hose to the tank vent receptacle. Open the gray vent valve on each tank and watch the pressure gauge drop. When tank pressure drops to 140 psi, close the gray-handled vent valves and continue filling until the station pump stops automatically. The vehicle should now be disconnected from the fill station and driven for 10 to 15 minutes to slosh the LNG inside the tank and ensure that the temperature within the tank is equalized. Once this short drive is completed, return the vehicle to the station. If the pressure is still above 150 psi, vent the tanks to 140 psi and restart the fueling process as described in Section 5, Fueling. Verify that the dashboard fuel level display indicates full. This completes the tank conditioning process, and that leads us right up to our next segment, which is leak detection and repair. Detecting and repairing gas leaks is extremely important. You should always follow proper safety and service procedures when working on any LNG system. Failure to do so may result in damage or personal injury. Please review the safety procedures in Segment 4 before proceeding. Let's take a few minutes and walk through the key steps in this process. Before starting any leak detection process, be sure to follow the safety procedures outlined in Segment 4. Now, if you suspect a leak, check all of the fittings and connections using certified leak detection equipment. Most leaks will be found at a connection. If the vehicle has recently been in operation, wait approximately 30 minutes without running the engine for the system to warm up to prevent leak detection solution from freezing. Performing a leak test on frozen fuel lines with large amounts of frost on them will produce unreliable results. You can start by using a combustible gas leak detector or by using leak test solution. When using solution, look for bubbling or foaming. Always give it at least 10 minutes, since not all leaks will be apparent right away. After a few minutes, even a tiny leak may appear as foam, not bubbles. Examine for frost or ice around tubing or connectors. Frost may be an indication of a loose fitting. And finally, check for signs of damage to tubing. Remember, before fixing a leak at a connection, depressurize the system completely or defuel if necessary, as described in Segment 8. Tighten a leaking tube fitting by using the proper backup wrench to support the body of the fitting, and then use a second wrench to snug up the tube fitting nut. If a leak cannot be fixed, the component or the tubing must be replaced. When attaching new tubing for the first time, finger tighten the nut and then tighten another half turn with a proper sized wrench. After repressurizing, always retest the repaired parts. If no leaks are present, apply Torque Seal. By following these important guidelines, you help to ensure your safety and the safety of others. At Agility Fuel Systems, we take great pride in all of our products. Our number one objective is to make sure all of our customers are satisfied. To accomplish that goal, we have assembled a team that is dedicated to you. So if you're experiencing a problem with your vehicle or are uncertain about any process or proper procedure, or you need a part, contact your local Agility Fuel Systems service provider. If you need to contact the Agility Product Support Group directly, call the number shown on the screen or email us at support@agilityfs.com. When you call, we will need your name, phone number, email, and the vehicle information. VIN, unit number, year, make, model, the name of the vehicle, owner, and its current location. We will assign a service advisor who will contact you and make arrangements to have your vehicle fixed or a part shipped. Please go back and review any segments in this presentation as needed as you operate or perform service work on your vehicle. For more detail, consult additional Agility resources such as the Operation Manual, Service Manual, or Parts Manual. This video is just one part of the training that is available from Agility Fuel Systems. If you have questions, comments, or suggestions about our training program, please contact the Agility Fuel Systems Product Support Group. I'm Tony Noakes, and on behalf of the entire Agility Fuel Systems team, we thank you for watching.